press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
Hello and welcome to NL Interviews. Today we have with us Prerna Bindra Singh, who is a wildlife conservationist, naturalist and writer, as she describes herself in her website. Prerna has also served on the Uttarakhand State Board for Wildlife and was a core member of the Standing Committee for the National Board for Wildlife. She's authored three books and one is a children's book. And today we're here to talk about one of her latest book, The Vanishing, India's Wildlife Crisis. Welcome to News Laundry.
Thanks, Nidhi. Absolutely happy
to have you with us.
Same here. Delighted to be here.
I'd like to start by asking you, why did you think it was important for you to write this book?
See, many reasons, but I'll boil it down to two. See, one is that India is one of the richest countries as far as wildlife is concerned. We have got this great wealth of wildlife. We are the maximum number of wild tigers, Asiatic wild elephants, also gangetic dolphins in rivers, and it's the only nesting place of olive ridley turtles. We have got creatures which are now largely extinct in other countries, like black bucks, and a bulk of the population of a lot of other animals, like the greater one horned rhino, the gharial, etc., etc.
Right.
And I find that we are therefore in a sort of way complacent. You know, it's great. I feel very proud that we've been able to conserve so much when so many other countries have lost their wildlife wealth. But we are at a space where we are not calling the crisis. So even when we have, we are, you know, 60% of the world's wild tigers, and numbers are stable, even increasing. Yet at the same time, we are at a place where we are pushing to projects which will drown a forest, a
right.
tiger reserve like Panna Tiger Reserve because of the Ken Betwa River link, or running highways through critical tiger corridors like Kanha and Pench. So you are expanding a highway through that corridor and a railway line through that corridor, which will essentially in the long term mean that tigers in that central Indian landscape, and it is one of the richest tiger landscapes in the world, will likely to be islanded and go extinct.
Right.
So, and equally, there are other creatures which are on the brink of extinction, like the great Indian bustard. We have fewer than 100, largely in Rajasthan and a few in Gujarat. The gharial, which is now only about fewer than 1,000 left. Chambal, it's extinct in Ganga, and it was the vehicle of goddess Ganga. You know, that is a cultural connect. So I think we are not calling that crisis. We are not recognizing that crisis. We are saying, hey, great, our numbers, tiger numbers are increasing, elephant numbers are good, we have got 27,000, so all is hunky-dory.
And when you say we, it's not just the state, because, I mean, you are critical of policy in your book.
Yes, yes.
But when you say we, it's everybody who's part of society.
It's everybody who's part of society. It's the government, it's the media, it's you and me. And so that's one reason we need to call the crisis. We need to recognize we've lost 97%, even more, of vultures. We need to recognize that the bees in our backyards are vanishing. We need to recognize that this is not just the loss of a bird, that it's linked to our welfare, because the loss of vultures meant we have lost a very efficient scavenger, which means that we rotting carcasses now rot and spread diseases. And in fact, it has increased dog populations who scavenge, but they are not efficient scavengers, and that means they spread zoonotic diseases like anthrax. And also rabies has increased. So the loss of a bird has meant a health emergencies. The loss of bee declines means we have lost a pollinator.
And you think like a health emergency, so until it affects us, we're unwilling to.
We are unwilling to. So the book talks of such links,
right.
How forests absorb greenhouse gases, how mangroves protect us from tsunamis and storms, how wetlands are sponge water. They serve as flood mitigation. So these are some of the links that the book draws on, and I felt that somehow we are not able to make that connect, even though what we're living in is something like an environment disaster.
Yeah, you call it an ecological holocaust.
Yeah, ecocide, an ecological holocaust.
Right.
We are doing this interview in Delhi, the most polluted city in the world. Mm. Our children's lungs function some half of their capacity.
Mm. You said 40%.
Yeah, there. Two Indians die every minute due to air pollution. So how come, and we are not able to recognize this crisis. Our answer is to buy air purifiers, not conserve that green cover which will help absorb those pollutants. Mm. You know, the air pollutants is not, buying an air purifier is not going to resolve the issue. Mm. So I think this book was like coming full circle. I came into wildlife because I saw the disruption. I love nature. It fascinates me and continues to fascinate me because every day I discover something new.
Right.
Yeah. Mm. I think I write about in my book. So dragonflies which come to my home.
Yeah.
And actually I've put a water bowl for them, and there's a little, first it was just a water bowl. Then I realized when the dragonflies came, they didn't have a leg to stand on.
Hmm.
So I put twigs in there, and now they have a leg to stand on. And I realized some species of dragonflies migrate for thousands and thousands of miles across the seas to the African continent. Hmm. So, you know, it's just fascinating. Trees communicate with each other. And I think I try to bring out that nature of animals in the book so that people connect with it.
Hmm. Even in the book, you say in terms of policy, you say that in the 1970s, Indira Gandhi's time was a golden period for wildlife.
Yeah.
What do you think changed, and why has it changed?
Yeah, it was, in the run up to 1970, of course, we first had the British Raj, and then immediately after that we had to rebuild our country. So the British Raj saw huge exploitation of forests for the railways and other industries, which was essentially to promote the colonial.
In fact, you start from the East India Company itself.
Yeah, exactly, because that's what the colony, the English prospered on the back of colonies, right? And we were a colony. Mm. After that we had to, and of course they also introduced the viewing of animals as pests.
Right.
Like Indians hunted, there are tribal cultures which hunt, there were kings who hunted, but it was not, animals were never pests.
Mm.
It was game, or for kings it was, you know, a prestige thing, a status trophy, whatever. But killing of wolves because they are pests and having a bounty, killing of cheetahs, killing of lions, killing of leopards. And that, so wildlife was already decimated majorly. And then post the 50s, because we had to rebuild our country because refugees had come in, so many forests were cleared and they were rebuilding. So modern temples, the temples of modern India, dams which submerged forests, etc. Mm. So by the 70s, we were at a time, and tigers were, there are ads, you know, which you can see calling shikaris to hunt in India to bag a tiger.
Mm.
But we realized there was this, that tigers were vanishing from a forest. When the shikaris came, there were no tigers.
Mm.
And the, you know, gentlemen shikaris had started worrying, and there was this. And also skins were being sold at because it was legal to sell them. And so alarms were raised. There was a story in Indian Express. Actually, one of the forest officers had also gone undercover and found that tigers were being sold in Chanakya market, tiger skins, snow leopard skins by the dozens. And this was brought to the notice of Indira Gandhi, and how tigers were vanishing, etc. And they, as well as other wildlife, black bucks and cheetahs were extinct, and great Indian bustards were down. And she, Yes, she was extraordinary. Mm. It was not just a passion for wildlife. I think, especially now reading a book on her contribution to nature, recently authored by Jairam Ramesh, it was shocked. She had a vision at that time at how nature is important to our development, for human welfare. Mm. She linked it to how the tribals are dependent on forests. She linked it to how development can only be sustainable if we, if we have ecological in the equation.
Yeah.
So we had the Wildlife Protection Act, the Forest Conservation Act. We had Project Tiger. We had a lot. It came in the concurrent list.
And all of this changed. Suddenly.
All of this changed over time, and by the 90s, we were
post-economic liberation.
Yeah. So two things, I think. One, loss of political will.
Right.
So post Indira Gandhi, we didn't, and political will is critical to conserve for, because it needs a kind of vision. These are, you know, you otherwise you see quick gains in destroying a forest because you'll have a cement plant there or you'll have a six-lane highway or whatever.
Would you say that post Indira Gandhi there was a redefining of the term development itself, which is when it becomes the conservation versus development?
Yeah, I find when I look at the old minutes of NBWL, National Board for Wildlife, I find they also struggled with same issues.
Hmm.
But it was at a much lesser scale. But yes, there was more so with economic liberalization. So post Indira Gandhi, you had Rajiv Gandhi, who didn't have that same vision or commitment. Hmm. But at the same time, he carried it forward. He had some, so we had the Environment Protection Act coming in at that time. But of course, it was also an answer to the Bhopal tragedy. It was a reaction to the Bhopal tragedy. But after that, in the early 90s, one was, as I said, loss of political will. And so, you know, a sort of listlessness had come into the whole wildlife. And there was a resurgence of demand for tiger skins, wildlife derivatives, as well as bones.
Hmm.
This wasn't realized before, that leopards and tigers and were being killed for their bones and penis and whiskers and etc. for traditional Chinese medicine. And because so management was protection, didn't have that zeal had gone.
Hmm. But it did come back a little bit when in the second term of the UPA, Jairam Ramesh came into power.
Yeah, it did do a while. Yes, it did.
And it was just called the roadblock ministry.
That was more of a myth, actually.
Okay.
But yeah, see, economic reforms, the problem that happened with that is that it did not weave into it ecological concerns.
Hmm.
Essentially, the dilution of all the safeguards to protect environment and wildlife began during that period. So since that time, you have some 25 changes in the coastal regulation zone, which protects our coasts. Again, it's not just the protection of turtles and dolphins and whales, but also the livelihood of fishermen, which is, and coastal people who live by the coast. That's a third of our population.
Right.
So you see again that, and yes, you talk about whether the roadblock ministry, that happened, I find that a myth, which I try and break. Even during the time when it was called a roadblock ministry or green terror by a weekly news magazine, we were giving over 90%.
India Today?
India Today.
Yeah.
We were giving over 90% clearances.
Hmm.
Whether in environment, so there are three set of regulations: environment, forest, and wildlife.
Hmm.
And you're giving, so they're over 90% clearances. So where is the balance? And I break it down. I looked at coal and the key sectors very closely: power, coal, steel, and clearances were given beyond targets.
Hmm.
So to call one particular ministry or one particular set of regulations as roadblock is too simplistic. I call it the convenient untruth. Because you are in a complex country like India, to lay the blame of slow growth or at the door of environment clearances is A, the myth, it's a myth, and B, it's just a simplistic exercise. And it was some study, which I quote, also said that It was also due to market conditions, etc., etc. So there are a whole complex, what is the economic climate globally? What are the labor conditions? What are the market conditions? All of that is not taken into account, but no, the environment clearance. So that is one. And the second...
Was it simply because Jairam Ramesh didn't hesitate to call out the issues with the state?
No, I think he was... He tried to... Well, he did say no to a few things.
And like he talks about the coal and iron mining.
Yeah. So I think that whole doctrine of though he himself says that clearances were over, he gave clearances over 90%.
Right.
In some cases, environment clearances may be over 95%. Currently, 99% of projects within wildlife protected areas or in the immediate vicinity are over 99%. You're perhaps refusing or not even refusing, deferring one or two projects. In the past 2-3 years, or maybe 4 projects. So I think Jairam Ramesh's time, that whole Dr. No or hurdle came about because he initially stopped some key projects. Polamuram?
Also the elephant-human conflict, he says, is a metaphor for the conservation
versus development. Yeah, and also there was no-go areas, right? That these are dense forests, these are water catchment areas. So those were actually all forest areas are no-go.
Right.
But even within that, he had said, and I think that no-go was very difficult for the coal ministry and the mining ministry to swallow. And that kind of made that whole Dr. No and development versus. But how do you develop if you don't have if you don't have water? If you don't have forests, we lose our water catchments, river catchments. So to me, this throwing one against the other is
a binary that shouldn't exist.
It isn't, because you can't, unless you're ecologically secure, you can't have growth that is sustainable, even in the short term.
Right. I'd like to quote something interesting you say. You say, what perplexed me the most was the silence that surrounded the obliteration of green spaces. I'm very curious about what this silence is. You know, my question is it a deliberate silence? Is it an indifferent silence? Is it a nurtured silence?
All three.
All three.
Deliberate silence, nurtured also, because I actually am still perplexed. At the silence, maybe we are not able to draw the links of why this is important. Maybe we have become very disconnected with nature. Like you ask a child today where milk comes from, you know, you actually see them hesitate unless they are, you know, really, because they're not boxed in, or how connected are we to nature? I mean, 8 hours a day we are sitting next to the computer, so am I. And also, we don't have an environment education. We don't have... deliberate silence, definitely on the part of the government as well, media government, because the ministry which is mandated with it for its protection is now, I'm very sorry to say, doesn't seem to be doing what its mandate is, because you see more of, you know, its task where you had a document published by the Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change in 2015, which talks of how many clearances they had given, how fast those clearances was, which protected areas it went through. And many
in fact,
of them
you say this government approved, what, 300 odd projects in 7 meetings?
Yeah, something on those lines. So in the first meeting of the National Board after they came into power was in August, I think, August 2014, and they cleared about 130 projects over 2 days.
Over 2 days.
Yeah, so
and
throughout the meeting was
ended over 7 meetings.
Yeah, so something along those lines. Those figures I don't remember, but I do recall that only 4 were deferred or refused.
Okay, was it for the sake of deferring it or?
Or refused, whatever. But even projects were refused, I keep coming back to you. So, I mean, again, the mandate of the National Board for Wildlife is to conserve wildlife. It's the only apex body which is. But unfortunately, it seems to be subverting its mandate to, you know, the whole growth agenda. And that is where, when you said, you know, defining development, did it change post-Indira Gandhi? I don't know whether it changed post-Indira Gandhi, but I find just defining development by the GDP is certainly something we need to rethink. Because it's a very narrow definition, right?
Right.
A GDP will increase when a forest falls.
Yeah.
Because that means that you have timber, where you access the minerals underneath. While a standing forest, which absorbs greenhouse gases, river catchment, conserves soils, gives us oxygen, etc., influences monsoon, etc., it's just priceless, but it has zero value as far
as money
is concerned.
In fact, you say that the moment we lose our forest, we are losing our fight against climate change.
Yeah, we are. India's forests absorb 11% of our greenhouse gases. So, and you know, mangroves also do it and wetlands also do it. So if we lose our forests and old growth forests, plantation doesn't do the, you know, it doesn't serve the same ecosystem functions.
Right.
And just to get back to the whole GDP thing, so GDP, when there's an air crash, GDP rises. So we are looking at, even when we have a 7% or 8% or 9% growth, we're looking at huge inequalities. We are looking at a very sort environment with, you know, people are falling sick because of. So I think we need to rethink and redefine, and it's happening globally. It's being questioned.
Yeah. But our Vikar Purush, right, man of development, has recently come out with a statement that's been going around, ease of doing business, which you call as a fatal sentence to the environment.
If it is equated only with weakening, diluting regulations which protect our clean air, clean water, wildlife, forests, wetlands, etc.
Which is how you read it equating.
It is happening. Recently, we had the wetland protection rules have been diluted, and a lot of our laws, rules related to laws have been environment laws have been diluted. There is a intent to rehaul and all the six key environment laws. So yes, if it translates to that, it has me worried. Because, you know, it cannot just be ease of doing business means ease of acquiring land, ease of acquiring forests, ease of. So that yes. I mean, we need to develop, but we need to also mainstream within it ecological security. Because
And if we were to talk a little more specifically about the tiger, India's been fairly successful in repopulating the country with tigers. But you also say that recently when Prakash Javedkar spoke about the success, the ministry was also orchestrating its destruction. Why? So the tiger's again in danger.
Well, someone said, someone is an authority only, then I think the former head of National Tiger Conservation Authority, that every tiger in India is vulnerable, not just from poachers, just because there's such a huge price on its head, but also because its habitat is being fragmented and destroyed at unprecedented rates. So while we have been remarkably successful in conserving tigers, you know, and the fact that we had 1800 tigers about when Project Tiger started in 1973, and we have about 2200 is a huge achievement given our population growth, given the fact that we are, you know, we have grinding poverty, and given the fact that we have this huge economic ambitions. Having said that, we can't afford to be complacent. Tigers are definitely in danger today. There are corridors which are critical because we have very isolated small pockets of forests, which are tiger reserve or sanctuaries, and they need to be connected by, if they are not large contiguous forests, at least they need to be connected by slim forested corridors which tigers can traverse. These are being hammered by highways, expanding highways, railways, mines, and
river linking projects.
As we speak, there's a move to push river linking project, which will drown just the first one. There are other consequences. Just the first one, the Ken Betwa, will drown Panna Tiger Reserve, beautiful forest in which once tigers had gone extinct, and the government of India and the government of MP worked so hard to rebuild it.
And you call out the EIA's analysis as being completely inept.
It was a complete disaster. The environment impact assessment is a very powerful tool, because for any project, it assesses what the environment impact of it would be.
Right.
And also is perhaps the only tool, not perhaps, it is the only tool where you take people's voices into consideration, the local people.
Hmm.
But most EIAs, and I quote for this, and I quote for a dam project in Arunachal, the Goa airport project, they are copy-paste of some Russian project somewhere, or have glaring untruths. For example, the Goa airport project, which is a biodiversity hotspot, and it has tigers, it has gore, it has pangolins, it has otters, signs of all which I saw in one shot. And all it says are cow, mouse, dog, pig, some such, you know, domestic species.
And these are purposeful mistakes.
Yeah, I mean, not done, in Jairam Ramesh called them a joke. But they're not, they are, and the decision to go ahead with a project or not rests on these EIA, at least the environment clearance or not, environment regulation rests on them. And, you know, they have far-reaching consequences. If that airport on Mopa happens, we lose, it has huge water consequences because 40 streams flow out of that plateau for Goa. It's a very critical tiger corridor connecting Maharashtra and Karnataka, Goa, Karnataka, that particular forest and area. So every project has economical, social, ecological consequences, wildlife, of course, which ecological is. But we seem to be treating them as jokes, a very poor joke. And the problem here is that the EIA is undertaken by the project proponent. So if you are building a factory, you employ the consultants, etc., to do the environment economic assessment of the project, which obviously means it will be biased. Because if you're paying them to
and
do it...
And nobody overlooks the process.
Not really. Hmm. Not really. So coming back to tigers, as a nation are committed to protect tigers, we are destroying even the most sacrosanct of habitats. There are plans to build a national highway through Corbett National Park. Yeah. This was where Project Tiger was born.
So the success of a Ken Batwa project could be us taking 10 steps back in terms of
tiger conservation. Yeah, if it were to come through, and Ken Batwa, I might point out, has been questioned even hydrologically because of the river flow of Ken and how much this... See, the concept of excess water in a river is a myth, but that's another story. So, I mean, how do we say that we commit to saving the tiger when even its most sacrosanct areas and corridors, there's a canal which was recently cleared, which connects the forests of Taroba Tiger Reserve and Kaval Tiger Reserve. The success of Kaval Tiger Reserve, because it's a new reserve, it's a battered forest, has very few tigers, depends on the health of that corridor, so that tigers from Toroba can still come in here. Once you have that canal,
there's no movement possibility.
It will mean the death of, and you allow these things. So unless, if you're not even saving the most critical of areas and the most sacrosanct of areas, the tiger reserves.
Yeah. And let's also talk a little bit about what's happening at Sundarbans. Right?
Yeah.
We share that space with Bangladesh.
Yeah.
Bangladesh now wants to build a coal thermal plant.
Coal thermal, and in partnership with India.
And it might actually mean, we might be breaking the code. We have a global tiger recovery plan which we are signatory to with Bangladesh.
Both countries are.
And this is not being addressed?
So there's a lot of protest against it. And so this is... thermal power plant, very close to Sundarbans Tiger Reserve in Bangladesh, which, and of course, that is contiguous to our Sundarbans Tiger Reserve. And this is the largest mangrove delta in the world, the only one with tigers. And if you have a thermal power plant so close, and that will also mean that, the traffic will increase. Ship traffic, carrying oil, coal, all kinds of toxic substances. And there have already been leaks there. Terrible leaks, if you remember last year. And, oil in water. And this is going through the heart of Sundarbans, heart, and there are dolphins there and tiger sharks there and a lot of other rare species. So doing something at the same that dichotomy or that lip service, when you say you are part of the Global Tiger Treaty, which says that you'll have 2x tigers by 2020 or something.
Yeah. 2022.
2022. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you are threatening, endangering something like Sundarbans and again the most sacrosanct of areas. Mm. Incidentally, that power plant is in partnership with India. Mm. And it's just one of the many industries that is coming up there. And again, tigers, when I've been to Sundarbans, the Indian part, and I find the local people there, and they bear the brunt of conservation at times because they have tigers attacking their livestock, at times even people. But they told me, and that is something that stays with me. One man said that tiger to rehna chahiye, bagh to rehna chahiye. Jab tak bagh hai, to jungle bacha hai. Agar bagh nahi hoga, to hum hi jaake usko pura kaat denge. Because of the fear, besides the understand the ecological thing, if there are enough tigers, there is enough ungulates who will keep the grasses and the in check. And
right.
So they understand it's an apex in the food chain, but beyond that, says it's the tiger who's the keeper of the forest. If he's not there, we'll finish the forest. So,
in fact, many times in your book, you point out how the tribal communities have a much nuanced understanding of the need for wildlife conservation.
Yeah.
So do you think that urban spaces sort of do not allow for that understanding to happen? There's a certain structure in which urban colonies are built?
Yeah, it is again losing connect with the land, right? They still have that connect. Having said that, we need local people and I have a lot of respect and we work with them. At the same time, it's a very complex thing because there are pressures with us shrinking forests. There are pressures of local communities also on forests. Grazing, extraction of wood, fuel wood, etc., which was earlier just for their consumption, but now something like an amla is for markets, bazaars, even export. So you have, they still have that connect with the land, and I find that more in the older generation. Living in cities, we are so removed from nature. Even though I would say, keep one water bowl or have one, if you have one fruit tree in your neighborhood, you are connected to nature. But we don't. Even when I visit, I find that the older people are more tolerant towards animals, more accepting towards wild animals. In Jharkhand, I went when a leopard had eaten killed two calves.
You narrate that in the book.
Yeah, one calf or two calves. And they were very blasé about it. Surprisingly, because they're really poor, the way we define poor. They were content in their little world,
right.
And they said, "Nay, everything that we have is because of the forest and because with the water we drink, everything, the fruits that we eat, or mala ghar bhi usse lakkad se bana hai, everything." So they said, "Ye to sarkar hai, tax mil lagega," and life goes on.
They almost say that it's the right of the tiger.
Yeah, and they say, "Humko nahi kabhi tang kiya." So, they know and respect each other's space, kind of. That's how it seemed to me. But over here, you had the leopard come in Gurgaon and we beat it to death. Not 4 kilometers from my place, I'm so ashamed to say. But, it was because we don't, we have lost the connect with nature.
There's also talk about media coverage of wildlife. You've worked as a journalist and you've also said the difficulty you've had in convincing your editors to cover conservation and wildlife. Has it gotten any better or has it gotten worse?
No, I find more coverage now, definitely. When I started, it was, I recall my first editor and I went with stars in my eyes.
Which year was this?
This was in 99 maybe.
Okay.
98 maybe. I went with
post-liberalization.
Stars. Post-liberalization. Yeah. When I went with stars in my eyes, thinking I'll change the world, the power of the pen and, journalism and change the world. And I wanted to write on wildlife and, just every, that it will become a you know, buzz or whatever. Hmm. And he looks at me and he says, ke, we don't need wild people to cover animals. Wo jab tiger, zoo mein jab tiger bacha deta hai, then we send the photographer to take pictures, and that's all that we need to invest in.
Right.
So, you know, that used to be, though of course, I said, okay, then what do you need me to do? Hmm. And I did everything from covering films and writing about hairstyles to pencil heels and everything, and wrote on wildlife. So yes, we have come a long way from there.
Yeah.
Of course, you know, there were pioneers before me like Usha Rai and all. Hmm. But they were, those were, you know, few newspapers like Hindu and even Indian Express, since who used to give it that importance. Hmm. But the, and now with the web space, I find there is a lot more space for in-depth coverage.
Digital journalism.
Digital journalism, yeah. Hmm. Of course, there are negatives to everything because in the sense that, you know, journalism, like you, like I said, in the context of conflict, it can, if it is not the correct kind of journalism, it can fuel the conflict, especially when it's by the minute, the way it is now, TV, etc. But yes, it's better. I wish we, I mean, the more, I wish like you have a sports page, you have
an environment.
And we bring it out of that box called environment. Environment is health, environment is economics, environment is, it's not, you can't put climate change in a little box, or you can't put environment in a little box, or wildlife in a little box, because it is all connected to your health. Pesticides causing cancers is what, you know, Silent Spring changed that. But it is an environment story, but it's not, it's a health story. It's and it's also an economic story, because it means, it has its economic and social connotations, right? So I wish we would, not just in media, but the idea is to, that it needs to be mainstreamed into not just media, but in politics and economics.
And, and do you have any little tips for people living at home in urban spaces, in the way in which they could connect, or little things that they could do to give back?
Well, yes, I don't know about tips. One is empower yourself with knowledge. Read, watch, see. There is so much information out there. You can start with my book. But beyond that, I mean, there is, that's one. The more you know, the more, and not just Facebook, etc. I mean, you know, find good sources. There's Conservation India, there's Sanctuary Magazine. There's so many books, there's so many films out there that you can
see. Anything in terms of action, like you say, keep a water bowl.
Yeah, so that's one. But also, get engaged.
Right.
Yeah, get engaged. So is there something in your neighborhood, like in Delhi when the ridge was being chopped down to make malls, or a water body which is over which you're building shopping complexes or something, get involved. There are people there now currently fighting for Mangel Bani. Lend them your support in whatever way possible. There is, you know, when you have that, you know, that sort of a march or whatever, you see 10 people turn up. You know, so that is your green lungs as well. So that's one, get engaged. Yes, keep water bowl outside, clean water bowl, change the water, dust bath, plant while, you know, just let your garden, don't make it too manicured, and watch the birds come, you know, it will create it's a whole new world when you wake up to bird song every morning. I have 20, 30 species coming at my doorstep. And think about spend resources. Don't unnecessarily waste water, waste lights, you know, put off lights, don't keep the computer on. It seems like small stuff, but this electricity comes from perhaps a dam which drowned a tiger forest or some villages, right? Or this glass that you see, is made from sand which is mined, which will, you know, which is the nesting habitat of ghadiyals and crocodiles and turtles, and also leads to collapse of groundwater. So everything that we use has an ecological footprint. It doesn't mean that you don't use things or you become a hermit.
Yeah.
But as long as you're aware of it.
And mindful of your actions
and take the small and spread the good word.
Right. And just last question. if you had a chance to meet Maharaja Ramanuj Pratap Singh, who killed about 1,100 tigers, you mention him in your book.
Yeah.
What would you say to him?
I would tell him that he's, I don't know what I would say to him, but I wouldn't shoot him. But it was a different time, yeah. I would say, look, you killed 1,100 tigers and man, look at the population now.
Yeah.
Your forests don't have 11 tigers now. Would you do it now?
Mm.
And, you know, perhaps, I don't know, man. I would just say give your kingdom away and make it a reserve for the tigers. Yeah, as atonement maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway,
but we have we have the modern avatars of the Maharaja. Now, right? Who are suited, booted and who would kill the tiger's forest in one efficient stroke.
The suit boot sarkar?
Maybe. I don't know. The suit boot sarkar.
Or the one who calls out the suit boot sarkar.
Yeah, all of them. Unfortunately, right. As I said, they're all culpable to different degrees.
Right. Yeah. But anyway, thank you so much for being here, Prerna. An absolute pleasure to have
Same
you with
here.
Us.
Same here. Pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you.